Good evening. I'm going to open up the Redevelopment Authority meeting for Monday, September 26, 2016. First on the agenda is receipt and review of annual fiscal statement prepared by Valerie Donovan. Joanna, you want to give a briefing?
Right, great. Thanks for coming here tonight, everybody as well. Valerie does our yearly and annual report that we are mandated to provide Rockland Trust simply because we have a line of credit with them, and they require us on a yearly basis, and she'll be reporting out the 2015, and it should be done between April and September this particular time. Because all that's going on, we chose to make it happen by now. Valerie Donovan, I'd like to present to you, and you can report out to our committee.
Hi.
Welcome, Valerie.
Thank you. Good evening. My name is Valerie. Actually, it's Barrasso.
Oh, Barrasso. No. I'm sorry. You come back.
Yes, so basically I took the information I was given and turned it into financial statement format for the bank so that they, can renew the line of credit annually. Basically, at year end, there were three cash accounts, money held for restricted funds for the Route 44 development, and then the profit and loss. Basically, the money that came in was reimbursements from the town for the 9,700, but they gave 5,000, so there's still 4,700 outstanding. And basically, the expenses for the year last year was 7,070. So that's basically where it stands. I need approval, get it stamped from you guys in order to submit it to Rockland.
Question from the board members. Charlie, you got anything?
I do not have anything.
Very good. Joanna?
I don't, but I want to make sure that Marlene, that Christine gets a copy.
I have it.
Thank you very much.
Okay. I don't have anything. I went over all of this. It's very well done. It's exactly what they're going to want. So I appreciate that. I'd entertain a motion to accept the year-end fiscal balance sheet.
Second.
You have to make a motion. I can't.
I make a motion.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Motion made and seconded to accept the document that's in front of us for our fiscal financial statement. Any other questions? Hearing none, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Thank you. Unanimous. Valerie, thank you very much.
Thank you.
We'll be in touch. We'll see you next time. Great. Moving forward. Item number two, future discussion on the urban renewal plan, 127-acre parcel owned by Route 44 Development, LLC, located off of Montello Street in North Carver. Marlene?
So if it's all right with you, I'd actually like to talk about point A and C together.
Okay.
So C are the design.
So just for one thing, clarification, point A is potential impacts of the coal and Melville residents, and C is design standards. Okay, good. Sorry about that.
That's okay. So last meeting, earlier this month, we started talking about the design standards and what those could entail, and I had emailed out some examples. I've spent a bit of time thinking about this and comparing it to the zoning bylaw, and frankly, it's my opinion that the zoning bylaw provides adequate controls for you for signage and for landscaping. What I would suggest you consider adding above and beyond what zoning entails are some controls for architecture. So zoning can't talk about the look of the building, and what I would have you consider would be things like the construction materials for the front of a building would be some sort of masonry construction. You wouldn't allow a butler type building to present you know, a steel front. So things along those lines. I also think that one thing that zoning does not adequately protect for it with this type of development may be noise impacts. The other thing that I think your zoning does do a fine job with is lighting. So I don't think we need to go into greater detail with lighting. Your lighting standards are pretty good. But you may want to consider some noise impact standards. So you might want to consider acoustical studies and modeling in advance. Especially for things like the rooftop units that may be on some of these larger industrial buildings. And then the architecture would also talk about how those would be screened from view and how they can further be baffled or muffled from hearing them.
Okay.
Along with the noise impacts that you should be considering, I think you should think about how you would like to, or if you would like to control the arrangement or the layout of loading docks in these buildings. So if you remember, this will be designed as with an internal roadway with a number of lots with potentially a number of different sized buildings. And over the course of the past couple of months, we've heard and talked a lot about making sure that those impacts from any truck loading docks be kind of oriented towards Route 44, oriented towards the south. And that would, that would essentially put the mass of the building between the active loading areas and the residential neighborhood to the north, along with the impacts of the lighting and for the parking lot and, you know, the truck lighting. However, since this is going to be a subdivision with multiple lots, multiple different layouts are possible, I'm most concerned with the lots that are going to be laid out on the north side of the property, because if you put the loading zones towards Route 44, then in effect the loading areas will be in the front of the building, which is not something that we generally would want to encourage. Now, on the lots that will be on the south side of the interior roadway, having the loading areas at the rear of the building, between the building and 44, they would be, you know, that would be ideal. So my concern are the northern lots and how you are going to, how do you want to control those lots that are laid out on the north side of the roadways and their loading areas. One thing for you to consider is to essentially not allow loading areas at the rear of the building and have them oriented either to the east or the west. So the building would show its face, its public entrance at the road, and then the back of the building would not have the loading docks, and the loading docks could be arranged on the side. So we don't have to make any decisions tonight, but I want you to have a discussion about this, because I think noise impacts are going to be probably are probably going to need the most care in what we're doing here. And along those lines, as I'm thinking about these and how it's going to be laid out provided that the park is successful. I want to talk to you about the house owned by the Coles and the house owned by the Melville family, because pretty much what we'll be doing by laying out these design standards is funneling these impacts towards them. So it, if you can see on here, I don't know if you can see my, so right here is the Cole house, and then right here is the Melville house. So if we are asking essentially the noisy side of the use to be oriented as towards Route 44 to the extent possible, those noise impacts are going to be coming that direction in order so we can keep the impacts to the north as mitigated as possible. So I want you to think about that, because I think in the case where you have a successful development here, where you have a successful industrial park, it's going to be hard to adequately mitigate the noise impacts to those two properties. So we obviously cannot be causing undue harm to them without it compensating them for it. So that's something that if you feel as an authority that you want to essentially orient the noisy side towards Route 44 and towards the east and the west, you need to seriously be considering whether or not you should be acquiring those residential homes because of the impacts the future development could create for them. Mm-hmm. Secondly, you need to consider the impacts of the internal access, the internal roadway network, and the fact that if you do not acquire those properties, they will be traversing the industrial park roads along with the truck traffic. So Montello Street is a public way that is now accessed by these houses through the Bog Road and the easements to the Melville House. If you have a successful development, you will have essentially a private roadway, a private way for this commercial industrial park that will be combining the commercial traffic, the industrial traffic, possibly with the residential traffic. I think that's a concern. I think that's a very legitimate concern. However, I think the noise impacts are the biggest concern that I have with how you're going to lay out the project to mitigate those impacts to the neighborhood to the north, and in turn, what will that do, and how will it impact the Cole House and the Melville House? So I'd like to hear your thoughts on the design standards, and I'd like to hear your thoughts on if you think that we will be laying out a design that will have negative impacts, damaging impacts on the Cole House and the Melville House.
I have a question.
Go ahead.
I don't know about the Cole House. I don't know if anybody lives in there or it's rented, but I do know Melville's house is rented. He owns the bogs and that house and everything around it. It's a rented, he rents, somebody is in there. If we were to consider the buy or approach them about that, do you have to buy the bogs too?
So Melville's house is actually on a separate lot. Let me go to the parcel map, if you can just bear with me for a second. So this one right here,
yeah,
Can you see that, Joanna?
Yes, I do.
Okay, so that is the Melville House?
Correct.
This one, 22-10, are the Melville Bogs?
Correct.
This 40 plus or minus acre parcel, 22-11?
Right.
Is the Cole property?
There's a small house on that property, right off the road.
There is. And 22-4, which is this piece, is owned by the Cole family?
There's nothing there as far as.
And 22-5A, this piece right here, is also owned by the Cole property. Now, currently, these two pieces here are the access, this is where the road is.
Right.
And these two pieces are scheduled to be acquired, and at least a partial acquisition of this one is to be acquired. So that partial acquisition hasn't been determined yet, the square footage. And then that partial acquisition right now does not include the Cole house.
Right.
You may wish to include the house in that partial acquisition. And right now, this 22-10-1, the Melville house, is not included in the acquisition either.
I know about the Melville, because I know the person personally who owns the property, Mr. Melville. But the Cole property, I don't know if they're here tonight, but I don't think anybody lives in that house, or if they do, it's rented.
Well, it doesn't really matter if it's rented or not.
Well, you know, it's not like, I mean, I'd like to make sure that we do the right thing. Don't get me wrong. Is that Jimmy? Okay.
Yes.
But it's not at this time. Okay, okay. I didn't think so.
Yeah, whether or not nobody's in there or not doesn't matter. It's still a dwelling unit.
Right, exactly. Okay. Thank you.
You okay?
Yeah, I just wanted to verify.
Thoughts on design standards? On some of the suggestions Molly's making?
Well, I read them, and I think I want to travel a little bit around. I think Marlene told me something about Plymouth in that area. I haven't been down there, but by next week I'll have an appointment there to go and have a reason to go there. So I'll be looking through that. I guess from the front of what you recommended looks pretty good. I'm talking about Plymouth now. Does Plymouth, as you go up these side roads that around that area you mentioned, are there these warehousing type things?
So the Plymouth Industrial Park near 80 does have design standards. They do allow Butler buildings. But you can see as you drive by what their setbacks are, what their landscaping requirements are. Their design standards are not especially strict. But they, you know, it's a built out example of an industrial park where there are some of these controls in place. You can see how these larger buildings do deal with loading zones and loading docks and parking lots and lighting and signage.
One more.
Yep.
Well, early stages, there was somebody out in the audience that talked about the Cisco one and talked about the refrigeration, and nobody gave it a good thought because overnight you have to run this refrigeration, and that's has a lot of sound out there, and I guess it can be annoying. How do you rectify anything? Because it's refrigeration. I don't know where the refrigeration is. Is it on the roof inside? I don't know. So can you answer that?
So that's what you need to do.
We need to define what type of buffering. In Cisco, for example, they have one outhouse that has some refrigeration, but they also have rooftop units for cooling. HVAC units, stuff like that. Those are things that we have to look at. So a majority of the commercial projects or industrial projects, a lot of their equipment on those type of buildings are on the roofs.
Okay.
So I'm trying to look at some design standards on how do you buffer that number one, on aesthetic-wise, and number two, on trying to buffer some sound, because sound is going to be an issue.
Right, exactly. If something's running all night long for refrigeration, that can be pretty annoying.
Yeah, so there's different ways that we should look at on how we're going to screen that. There's also other things that Marlene mentioned on the front facades, whether it's going to be brick-faced or some type of mortar-faced straight, or are we going to require canopies and some type of jog or dimension in the architectural standards.
Right.
Those are issues that we need to look at also, just so you guys are thinking about those things. What type of landscaping? And the landscaping end is covered pretty good in the planning board items, but if there's something else that we want to look at. Lighting's usually pretty good there, as she mentioned. The biggest thing, I think, the hurdle will be is the noise end of it and how we're going to buffer that.
Right.
And I got to agree with you with looking at the Melville and the Cole property. If a potential large-scale development was to occur on this site or up in this area within the urban renewal, those properties, I think, will be impacted.
Oh,
and if
yeah.
they are impacted, it's our duty to do right by it.
Right. Yeah.
Well, how's it going to be mitigated? Stuff like
that. Well, my question was, I realized the house, and I can understand buying a house, but those bogs are very expensive. We don't need to buy the bogs. Right? Do we need to buy the bog?
Well, there's a lot of... There are some developments that are up throughout Eastern Massachusetts that have bogs, operating bogs around developments right over at, what's the name of it? Ocean Sprays plant over on, off of the Rotary. They have bogs and waterways right out front. There's another development that's down the road that has bogs and landscape around it. So there are areas in Massachusetts that have active bogs around these type of facilities.
Well, my point is, I can understand you want to mitigate sound if somebody's living in the house, one or two of those. But bogs aren't, nobody's living on the bog. So is there a possibility that they own the bog, we just buy the house so it doesn't impact that? That's what I'm thinking.
What's on the deed?
Yes, as I explained, you have a partial acquisition in your matrix for the Cole property. That partial acquisition can also include the house.
Yeah.
Right now it doesn't.
Okay.
The Melville house is on a separate lot. That lot can be scheduled for acquisition on your matrix. Mm-hmm. This is what you need to decide as the authority.
I guess another concern that I'd have just talking out loud with you guys is the road access coming in through that property. How much of the property is going to be required for the road access to make sure that initial road access going up and through what we're saying is the Cole Road access, and that could be an improper way, but just to orientate you with what I'm talking about, how much of the impact that is going to be on...
I've been down that road, and I can see those houses, Melville as well as Mr. Cole's house. I can see it from the road.
Yeah, I mean,
no doubt about it.
The house is a question. It's the amount of the bog that's going to be required to adequately design that roadway.
Well, you can't do too much if you're going to build a road, you can't destroy a bog.
So just to give thoughts there. Charlie, you got anything on any of the design standards or some of the thoughts of what you think we should be concerned on buffering or anything like that up there?
I am concerned with the buffing.
Okay.
the design.
Okay. So I'd say that this is definitely something that we're going to have to look in for in our design standards for our noise impact. I like the idea of the acoustical studies being part of our requirements. Screening of all the roofs. What type? See, now it'd be a type of screening.
Mm-hmm.
You know. I don't know how to really classify that, so. And as far as the loading,
mm-hmm.
loading and unloading, I have to look at that. It's really hard to determine that without knowing what the development is. I guess we didn't put some type of standard in there, but. I don't know how that would work on some buildings and stuff, but I guess it would.
So let me do some more research, obviously, on all of these things, but especially on the loading dock.
I think that's a good point, though. I mean, trying to keep the noise away from the northern part of the property.
Mm-hmm.
I know there was a comment made by one of the residents on the Cisco property of listening to the backup sounds all the time, for the trucks backing up. And I'm sure that we'll have in our standard that there will be no idle trucks.
Mm-hmm. Would it be okay to have the loading docks on the north side? I mean the south side.
Just thinking, she had mentioned that, just trying to think of how that would, if that would restrict the development, or would it hinder a development? I don't know. Depending on, I can't really say what type of building would be there. That would be the concern. Joanna, you got anything?
Do the trucks stay there overnight, and the refrigerators have to run? I'm confused about that person when that person was mentioned refrigeration and it was running, you know, it was like a disturbance. And I'm not quite sure.
I can answer that. I'm from LinkedIn. The refrigeration does run 24/7.
Can I get your name just for the record?
Joy.
Thank you.
So the trucks by themselves
the
don't.
It's not a 24/7 trucking operation. It's would be Sunday night through Friday night, where they're actually working there.
Oh.
Nobody would be working Sunday morning, really, and the operation would be done Friday night. You know, the last of the picking orders and all of that. So you know, Saturday really would be the only day that nothing is.
So the only day?
Monday through Friday.
Monday through Friday?
Sunday.
Oh, Sunday through Friday.
They would start up Sunday. There'd be a Sunday through Thursday shift and then a Monday through Friday.
Okay.
And that's at the Cisco plant?
That's at the Cisco plant. And we did have complaints about the backup alarms, and we contacted Cisco, and they purchased muffling devices to help reduce that. And we haven't had any complaints since that.
Oh.
Wouldn't that only be on the companies that would be coming into the development? I mean, if we don't have any, freezers on, cooling system on the roof.
Yeah, but we're trying to think of what type of standards that we'd want to put in for this development, just in case. We don't know what kind of
right.
development's coming, if at all any. So. You know, just for an example, if, say, a Cisco was here, to look at those type of impacts. Just trying to think ahead of the game. Okay, Joanna?
Yeah, fine.
Okay.
So what about the architecture of the building and having offsets or varying heights, and I mean, what do you guys think about that? There's no way to pretend these are not going to be big buildings.
Yep.
My mind's not thinking about that attempt.
Okay, I'll just give some examples, just to maybe help you. You can look at the Deacon's plant, where there's.
Is that the one in South Carver?
Yeah.
Okay.
The Deacon's plant, you can go by there. That's a big operation, a big size building, but on the front of it, it's cut down, and the front part has a facade. You go up to Marion Way, look at some of the buildings up there. Some of the designs were to make a front facade with some brick.
Excuse me, Marion Way?
Yeah, Marion and also Commerce Way. Both of them up at...
Marion Drive.
Marion Drive, sorry.
And where's that? What town?
Plymouth, Carver. It's on Carver, North Carver.
It's off of Plymouth Street.
Off of Plymouth Street. Go up.
I live in North Carver.
Okay, so take a ride up to, like you were heading to Middleborough on Plymouth.
Street. Oh, yeah, okay.
On the right-hand side.
Okay.
Okay, there's two developments within the past probably 9 years.
Oh, and there's a big dump on the left-hand side? Yeah.
On the right-hand side, you take a look at those buildings. They have specific design features with a brick so far up and then a jog overhang, like a little canopy.
Okay.
To kind of, and they are Morton buildings.
Are they
that steel?
Steel?
They're steel buildings, but they've been changed a little bit so that way they look a little bit more appealing.
Okay.
Okay. Take a look at those. Those are the type of design features you want to look at. Now think of a larger scale, like a Cisco building or larger than a Cisco building. I'm trying to think of one bigger than that. That's close. The type of, do you want a straight-faced wall of just a steel Morton big building, or do you want it to look with some brick and some bump outs and some jogs in the building to break up the building so it doesn't look like one big block?
So one side where the loading would be, just loading, you can't do anything about that.
Yeah, that's just loading, but some of the loading can be jogged.
Okay.
You know, instead of just one up
big
in Rockland, up in Rockland Industrial Park, they have some that are on a side, so the building, you know, the side jogs, so the loading will be jogged. And think of those type of things. For separation design factors. I really think that the key is the front facades. So that way they're appealing. I'm not in favor of a big block building. Mm-hmm. It's just not looking right. So.
Yeah, well, I mean, when I go to Florida, I mean, that's all we see. It's huge depots for the, you know, big long, where the trailer trucks just back in.
Those are the type of things that you want to think about when we're talking about some of the design features or the architectural features, what type of material you'd like to see used, you know, whether it's brick and mortar or, you know, something like that, you know. Do you want sidewalks in front of them with some greenscape, you know, a little grass or what have you? You know, those are the type of things that you want to take into consideration on thinking of what might be there. Okay? Do you want to have windows? Windows on the front of the building. Well, some of these big buildings might not want windows because it's, you know, processing. You know? Do you want the windows to be smoked? Or do you want them clear? You know, those type of things.
How many levels?
I think the height would be restricted by
zoning. Yeah.
So just giving a thought to that. Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay. What other one were we thinking about?
What are your thoughts about the coal at the Belleville houses, structures, those houses?
The coal house in the Melville house.
Well, the house.
Right now, they're not to be acquired.
Right. I would think you'd, not the bogs. I never even thought we were going to buy the bogs. I always thought we were going to consider the houses because those were what bothers people. The cranberries don't care if it's noisy. I mean, and nobody's on the box, you know, 24/7. You know, they have these technology type things that let them know what to do, when to do it, and the sprinkler systems go on. Really?
Yeah, that's for
but
sure.
But nonetheless, houses to me would be the nuisance, you know. And yeah, his is not occupied yet, but the potential's there. The Melville house is occupied as a rental. I know it is. Yeah, I would say we have to concern the houses. I've never considered box.
What's your thoughts on that, on the houses? You want to move them to be acquired or not leave them as not to be acquired, the impacts on the houses?
But you can get the house without the bark.
Well, that's what I'm saying. Yeah.
We'll have to look at that. But I think
it depends on the owner.
I think it's quite clear that any type of large industrial use or that's going to be developed in that area, that those parcels should be included.
And should you get the bark, you're going to have to fill it in, right?
I don't think you can.
So just get the house.
So I'd say move them.
Add them to the list.
Yep.
The structures. Okay.
Okay. You want to talk a little bit about the roadway circulation before we move on this? What was it, option 5? I hope everybody, alternative, got number 5
so,
on the email list. I know that this was a combination of, what was it, 2 and 4?
1 and 4.
1 and 4.
Did it not look like this before?
It did. It's been, this is a combination of number 1 and 4 before, from the previous meeting, having this essentially escape lane constructed and then gated or closed off at both ends, and then the T intersection designed to not allow the trucks to make that turn, and obviously signed no left turn, and a dedicated truck route as part of it being south on Montello to 58, south to 44 east-west.
So Montello, the Montello that's in the Plimpton side, if somebody was to come down there, they would come down this road and they could take a right turn into the parking lot?
They could take, so a car, a private vehicle, could take a right turn from Montello, heading south on Montello, and take a right turn into the industrial park.
Trucks aren't going to do that?
The radius will make that incredibly difficult for a truck.
All right, that's what I wanted to ask, because if somebody does do that, let's hope they did it by mistake, and they won't do it again. They just can't make that turn?
Right, it's designed not to allow that for that size of truck.
Okay.
But as, remember, Montello Street is a public way. It's open and maintained for the convenience of the public.
Right.
So we do need to respect that the public is allowed to use it.
Okay.
Yeah. Well, let's pretend one thing. The person, i.e. it's a truck, coming down, what you just said, makes it very, very difficult to make that turn. But they can make this other turn coming, the continuum of Montello to the Cole property and go in the correct that way? Is that going to happen?
Yeah, I mean, I really find it difficult to see why a truck would be coming south on Montello when they could just stay south on 58.
There's a
I'm
just saying, you know, people come down all the roads they want to come down. And they could be coming from Plimpton. Trucks are coming from Plimpton, you know. and decides, oh yeah, Montello, that's exactly where I want to go. Boom, down that road, you know. You know, let's hope.
Well, this is why, I mean, this is why we are building this emergency lane here. I mean, this emergency lane can handle, can be ungated, and a truck, if a truck managed to get themselves there, head southbound somehow, this lane could be ungated and they could enter.
I think, I understand how that's going to happen for the time that whatever the street here, the entrance to Cole, where the Cole property is not going to happen. But I'm saying on a regular basis, when everything's going, Joe Schmo, or whatever his name is, coming down Montello from Plimpton, he goes, oh, Montello, exactly where I want to go. He goes down this unpaved road, which is narrow, comes to this point. Now what does he do? Can he make the turn in to park?
No, he cannot. The gate has to be open and
he or she has to make a left turn to continue down the rest of Montello and then enter the correct Cole property.
Entire intersection is designed not to allow truck turning movements. If a truck got itself there somehow, the gate would have to come down, they would have to come in the escape lane, the purple.
No, I think we need to think more of that.
So if this is not what the authority wants, tell me what it is that you do want.
Now, I think it addressed what our last concerns of trying to make that as less impact of possibility of trucks. I hear what you're saying. How do we prevent them from coming down through Plimpton's Montello to the site?
I'm saying if they did, by mistake, and got to
this... How do you prevent that from coming through Plimpton?
Well, that's what I'm saying. I can't prevent that, but I can say this. If I came to this intersection here,
yep,
and the person in the truck realizing, uh-oh, I can't go right into this through Park Ave, I can't do that. Can I make a left, come down the rest of Montello, come into Cole... through the Cole property where that person should have come in the first place? Is that how that's going to happen? I think that's my question.
So if I'm hearing you, you're concerned about the taking a left off of that and going down
the rest
south
of
on Montello.
Montello and
then,
entering in
then
the
taking a right on,
yeah,
Cole Mill Road.
Yeah.
Off,
yeah.
Cole
is
Road.
That going to happen? Can that happen with this design here?
I think there's an obligation to follow the truck route. And if that is being flunted, then that needs to be addressed. I mean, that is something that, A, should never happen by a professional trucking company. So, you know.
There'll be signs for the truck directions.
You can laugh, but there are reasons why you put truck routes in place. There are reasons, and they are enforceable, and you will be fined. So you have to remember that you're not dealing with a sand and gravel mine anymore. You're dealing with supposedly an industrial park where these truck routes will be established. They'll be properly controlled and enforced. This is not some guy and his brother who are going to own two dump trucks and pull out, you know, a couple loads of sand.
Yeah, but people make mistakes, and that's what I'm talking about, you know.
Yeah.
I have a GPS. My GPS says Montello. I could go down, if I was coming from Plimpton, my GPS would tell me... take a right onto Montello if I was coming from that direction. I know what these truck drivers can, and some people make mistakes. It could be, you know, just one of those things. And I'm saying, if that is happening, you know, I didn't realize we had to have two egresses or whatever you want to think. I thought everybody was going to come and go by one entrance, a coal property. That was it.
We've talked for months that you need to have two ways in and out.
Because that's an ordinance within the town.
You voted at the last meeting that this is what you wanted to see. So if this is not what you want to see, please tell me what it is you do want to see.
I didn't realize that the town was going to ask us to do this, or the fire department said you have to have another exit. Is that what they're saying?
Well, we haven't approached the fire department with any.
Somebody's requiring us.
The town's fire department has always required two ways in, two ways out.
And you have a 600-foot dead-end limit. And this road network is clearly going to be longer than 600 feet.
We haven't got to that end of the game.
Well, this is the preparation for it, because
we're trying to think of everything that we can.
Right. So I'm thinking of everything I can by asking you that question, and I think it's realistic.
Yeah.
People make mistakes.
This is true. That's a true statement.
Yeah.
So do you have an option for Montello Street then? Because this was what we were kind of combination of two options from last meeting.
Well, I don't, you know, the person is coming around this U, or was Y, I don't know how to look at this thing. Coming from the street, I'm telling you, off the Plimpton side. Can that truck or cars, it could even be cars for that matter, but more so with trucks, come down and take a left to continue on. Don't go over here. Can't go there.
The way that it's designed now, if it's a truck, no.
Okay, well, I think it has to be looked at a little closer to make sure then that truck comes down in the wrong direction, that truck can't go anywhere but left, or what's it going to do?
Go ahead.
Yeah, a couple of things. I think, and I hear what you're saying, and you just got to assume, my name for the record is George McLaughlin, and as you know, I'm one of the principals in 44 Development. I if I'm hearing you correctly, and I'm hearing the folks from Plimpton correctly, you know, I think we can agree that most of the truck traffic, and as Marlene says, you know, this is going to be a lot different than the historical operations there, because you're going to have big-time regional warehouse distribution facilities, and they're going to be like Cisco, running their trucks in and out. So, obviously, they're not going to go up the dirt road on Montello Street, because, you know, it's dangerous, the roads aren't paved, etc.
Hold on. One at a time, please, so that way I'm definitely coming to you.
And so, the thinking behind this was, if a truck comes down, let's assume the worst, because as we all know, things happen.
Yep.
And for some reason, a truck happens to be coming down 58, and as you point out, you know, the GPS, my GPS says I should go here, and it's the first time. I think the best plan, and I hope you folks agree, is that once this trucker makes the mistake once, gets down here and gets jammed up. I don't think personally, and you tell me, but I don't think personally you want them to be able to go right or left. Because if they can't go right or left, then that trucker says, man, have I messed up. I'm never going to do this again. Now I'm going to have to, as Marlene says, either call up somebody and get this unlocked so I can pull in, or I'm going to have to back up the whole length of Montello Street, which is a nightmare. But it's a nightmare for that trucker. And so that trucker is never going to make that mistake again. Plus, I'm involved in businesses with trucking. And trucking time is money. I mean, it costs $100 an hour to run an 18-wheeler. And if it's my trucker who makes that mistake, and the load doesn't get there, and it takes him or her 2 hours or $200, to do what they never should have done in the first place, they're going to hear it from me, and that's never going to happen again. So, you know, I think you're right. I think you're right to be concerned about these issues, and we can do whatever we can. Is there going to be a trucker who does that stupid thing?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yes.
There's going to be one or two, but I think that in this type of operation, that's going to be a very rare occurrence. I think that, you know, the type of tenants we're talking about in these, as a matter of fact, we've been having ongoing negotiations with a million square foot users. They're going to tell their truckers, you know how you lose your job? Pull down Montello Street from Plimpton, because if we hear from any of the folks in Plimpton about a truck going down that road, you're fired.
So
and so I think it's an issue. I think it's something to be concerned about, and I think this is the best way to defense against it. Things happen, and I just don't think it's going to happen that often.
But if it does, and when it does, who's going to take the responsibility at that point? The truck is stuck. Now, you know, based on your explanation, you either have to back up.
I think that's what you want. Don't you want, this is a good dialogue we're having, I don't think you want that truck to be able to make this left turn and go down to the Cole property, because if that truck can do that...
He's going to do it more often.
He's going to do it more often, exactly.
I understand what you're saying.
So I think Joanna, I'm not Joanna.
Marlene?
Yeah, Marlene. So if, let's talk about that access... Because we know that trying to plan for what-ifs is tough. So if we're planning on this, thanks, Bob. If we're planning on something like this happening, okay, how to address the protocols or put in our design standards to lessen that impact? Because I would not want to see a tractor trailer backing up that roadway.
No. And that's why you're building this escape lane.
Okay.
That's properly designed to handle the very rare truck that manages to get stuck there.
So another question that I'm going to have just for this, signage is signage. People normally can't read, especially when they're in a rush. They barely stop for red lights and they don't stop for stop signs. So signage on the Plimpton side, I know it's past our scope. How can we help that, is my question. It's signage is signage, but I'm just throwing it out there. I don't know how to fix that. Other than reaching out to Plimpton's selectmen and talking to them about it. We had two of them here.
Right, so you need to work...
I'm coming to you. 1 second. I just want to follow up.
So you need to work in your town.
Yep. Okay, so I just want to get this way...
This
sir.
Is the accident that is bad. Yep. There's already a sign on Montello
Inn. Yeah,
I'm sorry, Plimpton Inn and Montello Street that says no truck.
It's, again, just from my own experience, being up there and seeing people really don't stop for stop signs, so the truck sign is, for me, I just don't think that's going to be impacted. Ma'am? Okay, so that's good information for us, knowing that it's happening now from other things. So
it's happening now, the GPS will bring you down there, but I'm just saying for as a company who hires truckers to come deliver a product that's off of 58, they still come. They're a different, every Tuesday and Thursday is a different driver. We've gone over there, you know, just as a an example of a company that uses truck drivers to deliver their products at least twice a week.
All right, so I just want to try to get information. I want to get off of this intersection.
As an example, you know,
thank you. I appreciate that. So the concern is the intersection. Is the intersection? Do you?
Thank you.
Yes, and it's important. I did. Go ahead.
I'm concerned that you're designing an intersection to be awkward. And the no-through truck sign, as you say, is nigh on worthless. I know when I used to come down here, I used to commute from Rockland into the area. I wanted to avoid a traffic light out in front of the old Shaw's. That's reason enough to go down Montello, and it's going to happen, and it won't be just an accident. I'm concerned the intersection is designed to be difficult. It's the way you're talking, you're designing it for accidents. That if someone does come down Montello, you can't make the turn and stay in your lane. You're going to have to swing wide and get in the other lane. And meanwhile, if someone is coming at speed down Park Avenue, bang. Okay, you've got a blind intersection and an intersection that forces you out of your lane. And, you know, you might, I'm also considering you might want to put a curb down the middle. Right now you're showing yellow divided lines. If you have a curb, a dividing, as an extra discouragement of someone swinging wide, that may or may not be a consideration. But I'm not extremely pleased with this particular option.
Okay. Thank you. Okay. I'm sorry.
And again, about trucks, but keep in mind, they're going to be passenger cars.
Yep.
There are going to be hundreds, thousands of people working here, thousands of cars. People will come from Clinton, they'll come from Pembroke, they'll come from Whitman, they'll come from all kinds of places. And they'll want to avoid the light at Shaw's. They'll want to avoid the light that inevitably is going to happen at the beginning of Montello Street, Route 58. And there's going to be a constant stream of traffic down there. And it seems to me that there's just as big a problem as the trucks. As this gentleman points out, the truck drivers are spending a lot of money to operate, and they may make a mistake once. They probably won't do it again. But cars, there's going to be mostly, whenever the shift changes, there's going to be a traffic jam on Montello.
Oh, yeah, that's right. Oh, I understand now. Yeah, because people who live on the Plimpton side who could be employed at this site are going to come down that Montello. It's a car, very legitimate. It should come down there. Can it make that turn?
Yes. Cars can. Yes.
Cars can make this turn.
Yes.
Okay.
It's being designed not to allow truck turning radius.
Well, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay. So it seems like we're still at a we're still going to be in a problem with any type of traffic coming down Montello south from Plimpton. And how to mitigate that, I don't know.
Well, I think cars are legitimate. I don't think that's an issue. Cars can go use that road. I mean, it's a
dark road.
Yeah.
You can't even get two cars to pass. Like,
sir.
I don't know how you're going to restrict your intersection. If roads have standards, intersections have standards of how big they have to be delegated by state roads or whatever. So
yeah.
I don't know how you're going to do that. And I would suggest you just leave it. Don't put that on there. Just leave Park Ave as it comes out. They got to take a left or a right. And use signage. Instead of going through all that development. I don't know if they're trying to eliminate the corner on Montello or what their idea is.
We're trying to prevent the flow of traffic going up through Montello that way. For truck traffic. That's what we've been trying to address.
Avoid it to go up, headed north on Montello, past Park Avenue, go trying to avoid. Correct?
Yes.
So why are you changing it? They come out Park Ave, they're going to take a left or a right. And if the sign is here to take a right turn only, I mean, it just doesn't make sense to me that why bother to put all that in place.
Because people won't pay attention
to the signage. And they never have, they never will.
Okay. So while we have a little bit out this way, and we'll get back to this. It seems like we're still at a quagmire with the intersection. Concerns from you folks, or input I'm looking for, on some of the design standards that we were talking about. Go ahead.
My concern, I think you're right. I like design standards. My concern is, from my standpoint, once you start, I'm concerned about design standards that end up being very limiting on potential tenants. If the idea here is to work cooperatively to develop this lighted, decadent area and it create a lot of great tax revenues and jobs and what have you for the town. That's one thing, but I'm concerned. I think there's a real balance between, and I hear what you're saying. You don't want an unattractive development. I think that the masonry facades and what have you, so you're not just looking at a big metal building. I think that's important, and I think any tenant that we have in there would go along with that. My concern is, as you further start to define standards about loading and what have you, you may limit our ability to get tenants. So I think that one thing I would ask you to consider is a balance between having buildings that we can all be proud of and that look like substantial, nice buildings, not butler buildings, as we say. And I think that it's important to have nice landscaping and thoughtful landscaping, which is my vision of this park. But I get a little concerned when I start hearing about some of these other things. That's the only thing I would bring up. And then just, Mr. Chairman and Board, one other thing that I wanted to mention is when you were talking about the Melville residents and the Cole residents and also the Boggs. One tenant I have been talking to, and this is a million square foot tenant, we've been going back and forth quite a bit. They're very concerned about the access. If we could, can we take a look at that other slide, please? Marlene, thanks. They probably want to be located in this area, and that's what we're talking about now. And I've been talking with the local utilities, both Middleborough Gas and Electric and Eversource, about how long it would take to get the type of power we're going to need into this site. One thing, Ms. Layden, what you were mentioning about, coming in through the Cole property, that will be, I think, the main access. Because what will happen is once we straighten this out, you'll come in and then bang, you'll go right into the property. This particular tenant is very concerned and basically has told me in no uncertain terms that they're not interested in sharing their road with anybody. They want to be moving trucks in and out, and they don't want to be sharing them with residents or cranberry bog farmers or anybody. And so that's why it's very important to me for the bogs to be included. And what I envision, to be honest with you, I think the most attractive industrial parks are parks like El Knife and Sons. If you go up the highway, I mean, that's kind of set in a pastoral setting, and they have nice flowers and what have you. And So, you know, I envision as a developer, maybe, you know, who knows, keeping the bogs active. And as you point out, you can't do anything with a bog anyway. It's a wetland. You can't fill them in and build on them or whatever. But I think it's very important, really essential for us to control those bogs and for those to be included. And I've spoken with Jim Cole and his sister Alice, and I have to speak to the Melville family about getting together. I mean, and working out a deal. We've been successful in putting the Allen property under purchase and sale agreement and the Tassinari property under purchase and sale agreement. I've spoken with the Tushes. You know, they have, I mean, we have the lines of communication open, but they want to stay there. So, you know, I like to treat people as people treat me. So, you know, so be it. But I think probably I can put a deal together with Cole in Melville. I feel confident with Cole. You know, I'm a reasonable person, and I think more than reasonable, as proven by being able to put together a deal with Alan and in Tassinari. But I just wanted to raise that it's important, very important to us, for the marketability and developability of the site to have those blogs included. So that's the only other thing I wanted to mention. Thank you.
Okay.
I have a question, Mr.
Sure.
Chairman.
Go ahead. Yeah?
As you mentioned, if you the bottom pink line, heavy bottom pink line, which comes in, yeah, there's a big chunk of property there that looks like it's trying to get sold. Come down. Yeah, right there.
Yeah.
Can you come in there and along to the left and start coming in on the left.
Too close to the...
build your own road into the bogs.
I wish. And that's something I checked, and it's a good question. I checked with the Department of Transportation.
Yeah.
And you have to be... this is a no-access highway in this area.
Oh.
And there are certain federal highway standards how close you can build an access road and what have you. One thing the tenant is looking into is putting in a slip ramp over here. I don't know if that's pie in the sky. I haven't heard back from them. But putting in a slip ramp so that you can have access onto Route 44.
It would be great if that's the only way they could get in or out.
Well, that would be one way to get out.
And use the Cole property, not Park Ave, and use the Cole property as the second exit.
Well, what they'd do is they'd use this as the primary access in and slip their trucks out.
Okay.
That way. I don't know if the DOT will allow them to do that or not, but it's something we're looking at.
That would prevent that thing up on Montello, because you have another way out, right?
Yeah, I don't think, I mean, I'm open to ideas on Montello. I hear what these folks are saying loud and clear. I just don't know, I'll throw this out as food for thought, just while we're all here together talking about it. I don't know what the crowd from Montello would think about just, you know, cutting off Montello there and making it so that it was a dead end. I mean, is that something that the folks...
600 feet?
No. What I'm talking about is this. Maybe if we could go back, Marlene, to that other slide, please. And this is something my partner in VHB will probably shoot me for saying. But as I sit here, you know, we're all sitting around trying to solve a problem. You know, if all of a sudden we all get together and say, hey, let's just dead end Montello here, I think from the folks on Montello from Prince Clinton, you know, fine, you can't go out this way anymore, but it solves a lot of problems. It solves problems with safety for children. It solves the problem of both truck traffic and vehicular traffic. It's just something I throw out there. I don't know if it makes any sense. I
don't even know how we would accomplish that.
I don't either. And that's...
We were already told that can't be done.
Yep.
I'm from the Clinton Board of Selectmen, and
And we looked at doing that, and we were told that it would be too long, that the it would be too long of a dead end, and it wouldn't be legal.
Yeah,
okay.
But let me ask you this.
There's nobody living there after that.
Well, oh. Yeah, but if you had is I understand the dead end part, but if you had a barricade that could be blown in the case of an emergency or blown through or unlocked, is that something that
I think
be
that
done?
Would work if we had like a low island that a fire truck or police could drive over in the
yeah.
event of an emergency. I think that might work. We can certainly check.
I think it's something, I don't know, show of hands. And would people from Clinton be interested in that?
I think that's the first thing you've ever said that I agree with.
Well, see, that's a start.
That's
a start.
Hey!
Okay.
Now, I can't vision that. How come? I can't.
No. Picture this.
All right.
It's just a gate. You know, it's one of those metal gates you see.
Okay.
And so... it's at the end of Montello Street here.
Yeah.
So nobody's going to go down there. You can't get through the gate.
Okay.
But the reason why they have the laws that you have to have another access is because, God forbid, as you come off 58 at the other end of Montello, a tanker truck, an oil tanker truck comes in and explodes. At the same time, the person is having a heart attack at the end of Heather's Path. You have to have another way for them to be able to get in there. So what they do is they just come in and they, have the key to the lock, and if they don't have the key to the lock, they just blow right through it, the lock snaps. And
she has, what she's talking about is an island?
Well,
the raised surface.
Any type of thing.
Traffic. You have to be able to access it, and they can have bolt cutters when they just cut the lock.
Yeah, but you always have it set up so we're.
What happened to the bullocks? You can't use those?
No. Those are a little more complicated because if you don't, these gates are set up so that if you have any type of emergency vehicle or whatever, and you don't have the bolt cutters, and you can't find the keys.
Right.
Bang.
Okay.
And it just snaps.
Okay.
The bullets
so
are.
That would be something that you would look into.
Absolutely. Why don't?
Yeah, we'll talk.
Yeah. Talk about.
Good.
A
it's fine.
Is the gate before Park Ave coming down that Plimpton side?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, sure. I can understand that. Thank you.
The miracle of the iPhone.
Gotta love it.
Oh, great. I like that.
Okay.
That's
thank
you
can go. For that.
Yeah. Well,
can I just throw in another idea? I apologize. I'm really late getting into these discussions. But it appears that the former Shaw's property is part of this parcel, and I was wondering if there was any talk of using that access off 58 as your secondary access, and that way you'd be crossing Montello rather than traversing Montello.
The former Shaw's?
The former Shaw's
property. Were the tractor suppliers and stuff?
Yeah. Steep.
We looked at that to the left hand side of the old Shaw's Plaza. I'll use that is all wet.
Oh, is it? Okay.
The Business Development Committee had looked at that probably 7 years ago, and we had some engineers take a look at it, and they said that it would not be able to handle the truck traffic on that. So. Because of the wetlands and stuff that's there in that embankment. Sir?
There is an access here,
yep.
Which might be usable as an emergency approach. They've currently got it blocked with a couple of big rocks, but if
yep.
you need an emergency access, it's available.
Yep.
I have another question, Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
The entrance off of... Montello 44.
Who are we asking?
The Webby property is a TBA to be acquired.
Yep.
Partially.
A portion of it.
Now, today, as it stands, that corner of the Webby property, you have to come in to go to Dunkin' Donuts, come in to go to Aubuchon's, and come in to start of that Montello. I think Marlene was talking about on... you could widen the outside, the road itself, and then acquire some Webby property and fix that whole corner?
Right, yeah, in here.
Yeah, right.
That's been discussed at every meeting.
Really? Really? As fixing it? I don't worry about that.
Yeah, we've talked about realigning that at length.
Okay.
Yeah. I'll go through it again with you.
Okay. Yeah. No, I guess the point I'm trying to make is, instead of coming in at that point, could you acquire some of the Webby property towards where the coal entrance is, right off the highway, and just come straight in with that?
That is to be acquired. There's a portion of that is to be acquired.
Mr. Chairman?
Yeah.
Joanna, as we've discussed, the realignment of Montello intersection with 58, it's been pushed as far north as we can before we get into the wetlands. So we've talked about the that's on your concept plan that you voted.
Okay. I just was going to look at that a little closer. Yep.
Design standards from you guys, got anything on that, sir, please?
Wood mansion in Dillon Street. Demand from Boston is not in favor of design standards. Mostly in favor of putting money in his pocket, but I can assure you...
Let's keep it not personal.
And it's a profit motive, because they're not going to be kidding anybody. I'm not really telling any fibs out of court. It's going natural. But the issue is the people... and the neighbors up there influence and are concerned about design standards.
Yep.
A couple of weeks ago, you may have seen in the Boston Globe real estate section a very interesting story about what happens to people who live on the border between two towns, where at the one end of one town, they've got some land that's been pretty useless over time, they want to develop it, and the other town is residential. And they told us one story, this poor man who lived in the same house for 30 years and looked out at the woods behind his house in the neighboring town until they came in and developed an industrial park, and EMC built their world headquarters there. So now this man looks out in his backyard at a multi-story building in which the lights are left on 24 hours a day because they're a 24-hour operation. And he said it feels like someone drove the Queen Mary into his backyard and parked. It seems to me that that's the kind of thing that wouldn't happen here. So design standards are very important, and I urge you, because the developer downplays the idea, not to ignore it, and of course it quickly changes the subject to something else. But it's very important.
Do you have
a lot of time and effort, and I think that it's important that the community weighs in.
Yep. And if you have any suggestions of type of standards, I'm asking for that. Thank you. Sir?
I like the idea of the east or west alignment on the parking bays. I'd like to suggest west, as the Heather Path properties are towards the east. If you've got a choice, lean west. That's all.
Okay. We okay? And if you guys have any, just forward them to us, please. Just looking for your input to include you in this. Okay, so the intersection is still going to be an issue.
So I need some feedback from you about what you want to see next.
Well, me personally, this is a combination of those two plans. I'm okay with this. I do like the idea of the raised structure in that roadway there.
So I do want to talk about that.
Okay.
Because the DPW, so this is designed on the DPW's request that we not have any islands in the street because of the damage it does to plows. So we are controlling this through the radius of the curves. So if the islands have, you know, traffic signals or signs or something of substantial size in them. But curbing is especially difficult because it gets buried under the snow.
Okay.
So there would be just lines on the road, which you couldn't see when the snow comes either.
So this is designed to control the turning radius, the curves at the intersection, and then it's just striped with a, like a road, a fog line and a center line. There's nothing in the road here.
So I'll say this. Why don't we, as a board, you guys can digest this. I know that this came out to us to look at. If you have suggestions for changes, get them to Marlene before our next meeting. Other than that, we're going to just stand pat for right now what we have presented to us and get a better feel for it. Because I'm okay with it.
So the intersection is designed to not allow a semi-tractor.
Yeah.
To make these turning movements. It is designed as a stop sign controlled intersection to allow cars and light duty trucks to easily make that turn, including your emergency apparatus. So this prevents the tractor trailer only.
So, if you're coming down, you're going into that property, you're not going to go right down Montella because we talked about having a gate there. Why? You know, that's an emergency thing. So, somebody coming down here, coming in from the Cole property, north, south, I don't know. You're coming in here and the person's not going to take a right. To go down to Montello, right? Because we're going to have a gate over there. We just talked about that. Everybody thought that was a great idea.
The gate was a proposal to block off the Montello Street in its entirety.
Really? So no one's going to take a right down Montello?
First, be clear that to do that wouldn't just say, okay, that we're just going to put a gate up because it's a public roadway. So that would be something that the Plimpton Selectman's going to look into and come back with some information for us. We can't do that.
So let's think that this is an open item. They're going to go back and start working for us on our behalf. This layout's going to change. No one's going to go down towards Plimpton.
I would not change this even with a gate. Gates can easily come down. Yep. I would design and build this to prevent this turning movement, whether there's a gate or not.
So like I said, we're going to hold off until our next meeting because I'm sure that you have more input that you want to give to this.
Well, you know, when it snows, I'm not going to see the lines on the road.
I want to keep moving with this stuff.
DPW might have a problem, but...
Do you have anything? Okay. So that's what we're going to do.
Okay.
Design standards, road circulation, potential impacts. That's all that was on the agenda. Okay?
And what are we adding to the list to be acquired?
We were going to do the two parcels, Cole and Melville.
In their entirety?
We're going to look at them separately or four pieces or two pieces? Is that your question?
It's right now, though. The Cole property is one, right? That's one continuous piece of parcel.
So I'm asking,
including the bogs.
Including the bogs or not, right?
That's including the bogs, because that's one parcel right now. It's not like we're separating bogs out. And the Melville property has a house on it?
Right now you are showing a partial acquisition of the Cole property,
yes.
Not including the bog piece, part. And you're not showing any acquisition of them, either of the Melville pieces. So I really need you to be 100% clear here on how you want me to change your plan, because I need this information to move forward with the plan. So do you want to include only the houses, or do you want to include the houses and the bogs?
And you, Charlie? Houses and bogs? Is that what you want to do?
It'll be
houses and bogs.
Okay. So both Melville pieces and the Cole piece in its entirety.
Okay. That's all we got on this agenda for this item for this meeting. So, do you have anything else, Marlene?
No.
Charlie?
No.
Okay.
On number two, no.
Okay. Very good.
Can I just ask a question?
Please. No.
I actually met with our highway surveyor before this meeting, and he liked the idea of the bow island. And I was wondering if you are with you folks, if he contacted your DPW just to talk about it.
More than happy to open up communication between the two towns.
Great. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And thank you for coming tonight. We appreciate it. Next is bills payable and treasurer's report. Thank you, everybody, for your help tonight. Thank you.
Okay, that
what
be
you
me.
Got?
That be me. I don't know if we have any bills payable, Marlene.
We do. We have one bill from Valerie Verasso.
$300.
For $300 for the preparation of the financial statement, and we also have
Christine for
no,
17.
You're current with Chris.
Yeah, okay.
What did she say?
We're current with Chris. So this is the only bills payable. What's
well,
the pleasure of the
meeting
board?
Would have to go to Chris. So we have tonight's meeting.
This is the only bill that we have bills payable on. It's the only bill that's bills payable is an invoice dated for 9/20/2016 from Valerie Verasso. Invoice number 90. It's in for preparation of 2015-2014 comparative financial statements. It's for $300. What's the pleasure of the board?
We have to move some money.
We've got to do this one first.
So I won't give you a total because... you have, if you look at the bottom line on the report that I'm presenting, we only have $78.07.
Yep. If we vote to approve and to pay this invoice, then we'll take another motion to move money to cover the bill.
So moved.
Yeah. So that's a motion to pay Valerie's bill?
Mm-hmm.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Motion made and seconded to pay Valerie's bill. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Very good. Now you can address the deficit in the checking account that we have to move money to cover this bill.
Okay, at this point in time, the checking account, and this is without statements from Rockland. This is something I put in because from the last meeting we created movement. We had some bills to pay. So on the savings account, we moved $3,751. Moving that into the checking account, we paid two bills. One of them was the $75 for the minutes for the secretarial cost. And the other check was for Serpent for $3,675.56. As you see, we only have $78.07 left in that checking account. So at this point in time, we're going to have to entertain a motion with a dollar amount that I would need to go and move some monies. I would ask, Marlene, do you foresee more expenses coming up like within the month for some other bills that we can move more money than what Brian had anticipated yesterday? Brian wanted us to only move a certain amount of money.
Yep.
If we have some more bills coming up, knowing that it's coming up rather quickly, then maybe we can move a chunk. But maybe we can just $375 to pay these two items. So it's a pleasure of the board.
What's your motion?
I guess we can stay. I would entertain a motion that we move the $375 from the savings into the checking to pay these two bills that we talked about.
Which two bills? We only have one.
Well, one bill and one invoice from Christine for the secretarial expenses.
We were current.
You're current.
So it's only the one bill of $300.
How can we be current? She comes at this meeting today.
We're current up to today, so.
All the invoices have been paid. When you get the draft minutes from today, you'll get another invoice.
Right. So at our next meeting, that'll be an invoice that will have to be paid. The only invoice that's on the table is the one that the board just approved, was for the $300. So we should only have to move $300. She's okay.
Her attendance tonight will be paid by next meeting?
Will be on the next meeting's agenda.
Okay.
Okay.
Well, why don't we just go $375 so I don't keep going to the bank all the time.
Yep.
Not my favorite place every day.
So that's your motion?
Yeah, I'd like to move $375 from the savings to the checking.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Motion made and second to move $375. All in favor say aye?
Aye.
Aye. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. The minutes, we don't have the minutes.
They're on my desk.
That's okay. We'll just move them to the next meeting.
All right.
Next meeting date is October 24th. It'll be at 7 o'clock right here. What is the pleasure of the board? You guys look at your calendars, see how...
October, what is it, please?
It's October 24th.
Okay. I have no problem with that. I don't know about Charlie.
That's Monday?
That is a Monday.
October.
No problem.
Okay, somebody would like to make a motion for that date? Schedule our next meeting.
I move that the July meeting, excuse me, that the October meeting be set for the next meeting for the RDA, October 24th at 7 p.m. Will this be the room?
Yes. Do I have a second?
Second.
Motion made and seconded. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Entertain a motion to adjourn.
I move that we adjourn.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Motion made and second to adjourn. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. We're at 8:32. We're adjourned.